Good evening, everyone. Just in case we need to clarify who's who, I'm Harry and this is Dan. I just want to give a brief primer on how we know each other. Dan and I met in Santa Monica in a bowling league. And I just want to say that as a bowler, he's a fantastic writer. No, I'm just kidding. No, he's actually a pretty damn good bowler. And I think it was a sort of an instant man love thing that we had with each other. He's a tough Irish kid from Philly. I'm a semi-tough black kid from the south side of Chicago. We share many things in common. We're going to get into some of those issues today. But I also had the great pleasure of being able to read some of Dan's work. He shared something rather personal with me, a story from his childhood, which I found extraordinarily elegantly written. I find Dan, in the writings that I've been able to have the privilege to read, to be a kind of modern iteration of Pete Hamill and Ernest Hemingway. Hamill, of course, is still with us, but nonetheless, that kind of wit, unfailing honest self-honesty and self-assessment, I think is rare. And I am honored to be able to talk to you tonight, and we're going to get into American Wino.
Thank you, man. That's such a weird thing to sit here and have someone say these things about you, but you can keep going if you want. Thanks for coming, everybody. I know most of you. It's good to see you. And I think I'll read a little bit of the book. Nobody minds. We should have wine, though. Shouldn't we have wine?
I think it's only civilized.
Yes.
We've got water.
What's going on here?
We'll have that. Too. We'll have it up. But yeah, before you slur your words, you should probably do a introductory reading, and then we'll get into some back and forth, and then we're going to open up for a question and answer.
I'm going to read the whole book. Here we go. Actually, I told friends of mine, I thought it would be funny if you showed up at a reading and just read the end. Got the end, went the end. Here we go. I'm kidding. I love you all. Okay, so a little background on the book. A couple years ago, I'd finished writing. I ghost wrote a book. You know the show It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia? So I ghost wrote a book for them, and I finished that. And then a girlfriend I'd been with for a few years, and I broke up. And so I was kind of at this crossroads. I'm home, and I'm having wine one night. And over a glass of wine, I thought, well, what am I going to do now? I was like, oh, I have more wine. So I had a little bit more wine. And then after a little bit more wine, I thought I'm going to have all the wine in America. And so I pulled out my laptop and I Googled wine in America. And that's when I discovered that they make wine in every state. Hi, Carm. They make wine in every state. I'm sorry, it's like a reunion here. I'm seeing everybody. They make wine in every state in the United States. And so I thought, well, that was pretty cool. So I pitched my editor at HarperCollins on this idea that I would drive around the country and drink wine, because why not? And she said, it's good, but there needs to be more to it. There needs to be a hook. I thought, all right, well, let me get back to you on that. It was a couple days later, I called her and I said, how about this hook? At the end, I'm going to do a seminar at a really fancy wine festival as the leading expert on wine in America. She said, it's great. What's the festival? The Pebble Beach Food and Wine. She said, excellent. They're into it? Absolutely, they're into it. I never ran it by them, by the way. So yes, they want to do it. And so we made the deal, and then a couple weeks later, I think I called Pebble Beach and ran it by them, and they said, okay. And then in the fall of, what is this, 2016? So 2014, I left by myself, and I drove for about 3.5 months, 15,000 miles in my Toyota SUV, FJ Cruiser, who I named Carl Vehicle. And I didn't go to every state, but I went to every region of the U.S. I went up north and through Big Sky Country in the middle of the country and down the eastern seaboard through the south, Georgia, Louisiana, you know. And it was great. Okay. And we'll talk more about that. So here's a little bit from Wyoming. Wyoming, which is wine country. Wyoming has the fewest wineries in the U.S. They have 4 wineries. And I went to 2 of them.
That was enough?
Yeah. good stuff. Yeah. Okay. I cruised east to Cheyenne, then merged onto 85 North and drove that 70 miles to an itty-bitty outpost in Goshen County called Huntley, which is spitting distance from the Nebraska border. For the record, my many Wyomingites take considerable pleasure in hawking loogies at their neighbors to the east. The last time a census was taken in 2010, the population of Huntley was 30. There's a winery in Huntley called Table Mountain. As I mentioned earlier, Wyoming only has but four wineries, so I figured I had to stop and see the place if I was in the neighborhood. The Zimmerer family farm was established in 1926. Four generations have worked the soil, grown crops, and kept the place solvent through some tough times. The Great Depression, the Reagan administration, dubstep. Over the past 90 years, the Zimmerer farm has seen sugar beets, beans, alfalfa, corn, and cattle. In 2001, young Patrick Zimmerer completed his senior thesis project at the University of Wyoming on establishing vineyards in the Equality State. As part of what he described as a research project gone wild, Patrick convinced his family to plant a small vineyard, a mere 300 vines. A few years later, he and his sister entered a business plan for a winery into a competition at the university and won $10,000. The home of the Wyo wine was born. Bear in mind that growing grapes in southeast Wyoming is goddamn some bitch. But despite the myriad challenges, among them selecting varietals that stand a fighting chance and convincing sentient human beings to drink Wyoming-made wine, Table Mountain Vineyards has only expanded over the last decade and a half. They now have nearly 10 acres planted with 10,000 vines, yielding cold, hardy hybrid grapes capable of standing up to Mother Nature on even her worst bad hair days. We're talking sub-zero temperatures in winter, scorching heat in the dog days, relentless high winds, and unpredictable precipitation. Farming is a tough business, especially for a family competing with conglomerates. But when the big boys came through offering cash for their land, the Zimmerers held out. Because this is Wyoming, damn it. Their state mammal is the bison. Their state reptile is the horned toad. And their state fish is the cutthroat trout. Pat planted vines in a place where most folks had never had a glass of wine before. And now, if you stop by his tasting room on any given weekend, you'll find some straight-up working cowboys in there sipping on rosé. They're not just in business, they're making history. I, on the other hand, was making a different sort of history as the guy who had lied about himself and his abilities to more U.S. winemakers than any other. The miles and winery visits had begun to seriously pile up, and as they did, so did my anxiety about my ability and or continued desire to transform myself into the leading authority on wine in America. At every stop along the way, I'd tell anyone who'd listen about my ambitious plan for achieving complete oenophilic omnipotence, and virtually everyone had the same basic reaction. What I was doing was amazing, and I was an extraordinary human being for doing it. Man, it felt good when they said that. At first, anyway. Usually after they said that, though, they'd go on to say a bunch of stuff about phenolics and racking and other tedious winemakery gobbledygook that made my eyes glaze over, especially after I'd been driving for 6 hours and had thrown back a couple of glasses of whatever it was they were pouring. It was only an hour's drive from Huntley, Wyoming to my next destination, Sonoma-based winemaker Sam Sebastione's vacation home in Bayard, Nebraska. But boy, did I ever do a hell of a lot of soul-searching out there on US 26 East. What the hell are phenolics anyway? I honestly didn't have a clue. What I did know was that anyone who actually knew anything about wine could probably tell you what a goddamn phenol is. Yet after nearly 2 months of driving all over the United States, supposedly doing serious wine research, I could not. Phenolics obviously played an important role in winemaking because I'd heard numerous winemakers mention them. I just hadn't bothered to ask out of what? Embarrassment? Laziness? Indifference? What the fuck had I actually been doing out there that whole time besides driving, jerking off, feeling sorry for myself, and getting wasted, usually in that order? Halfway through my trip, my grasp of the fundamentals of wine production remained tenuous at best. Not only was I in the dark about phenolics, I also knew dick about fining, residual sugar, degorgement, malolactic fermentation, bricks, and pH levels. And don't get me started on how uninformed I was about racking. I'd learned precisely one thing about racking that had nothing to do with boobs. And that, implying that it does, will get you a nice crisp smack in the face. Still, here I was, halfway across the country. It was a little late to ask for a do-over. Unfortunately, it was also too late in the game to start querying folks about the fundamentals. It reminded me of that awful moment of every school year when I realized I'd screwed up so badly, the best I could hope for if I busted my ass all day and night was a C+. Imposter syndrome is the condition where successful people are convinced that deep down they are frauds who don't deserve the triumphs they have earned. I was beginning to think I suffered from reverse imposter syndrome. I knew I was completely full of shit, yet I felt I deserved complimentary stays at vineyards and fancy dinners, and happily accepted people's praise when I told them my aim was to become the leading expert on American wine. As I drove into Bayard, the truth hit me hard. I had set myself a preposterous goal, and I'd encountered toddlers at some of the vineyards who knew more about grapes than I ever will. But my date with destiny at Pebble Beach loomed in the distance nonetheless, as did the deadline for this book. So I made a decision. I knew how to fix this. It was time for complete commitment. Enough with the half-hearted approach to becoming America's leading wine expert. If I wanted that C+, I was going to have to man up. I would become an expert, all right. In fact, I would become the leading expert. I would become the leading expert on talking about becoming a wine expert. This was something I knew I could accomplish.
So, Dan, there is a phrase in Latin from my seminary days, in vino veritas, meaning the truth in the wine. Yes. So what truths about yourself did you learn on your excursion through wine, through the wine country of the United States, which, as it turns out, is everywhere?
It is everywhere. Well, you know, early on, so when I had the idea, I was probably more busted up about my relationship ending. And like any creative endeavor, it can transform itself into something else, you know. So when I started, I thought, man, I need to get out of L.A., you know, this gorgeous, screwed-up bubble of L.A., and hit the road. So I started in Napa and Sonoma, and then I went to Oregon and Washington State. So I'm, you know, it's like the primo, like, that's it, man. That's the best wine in America. And then you sort of cross that line. Actually, it's called Idaho. Once you go over there, it's a major drop-off. Let's just say the wines of Montana don't measure up. So right around there, and you and I talked about this earlier backstage, was I was feeling so low, but yet you get out there and you just see this magnificence, you know, like Idaho and Montana and Wyoming. I don't know if anybody who's been there, but it's breathtaking. And there's something really soulful. Even though your ass is hurting and you've been in the car forever, you just pull over and you go, damn, like, this is amazing. And so probably right around that time, and having spent a lot of time alone, it started to change for me. I wasn't so much wrapped up in the ex-girlfriend thing as I was more thinking about my brother, Brian. Did I talk about? I didn't talk about this, you know. I should probably bring that up. So my brother, Brian, in the summer of 2010, he jumped off the Venice Pier, where I live in Venice, on the 4th of July, screwing around, and got caught in a riptide, and he drowned. So that was almost 6 years ago. So I took his ashes with me in a mason jar. It was right beside me in the car. And he started having conversations, which is freaks you out to no end. You know, there'd be times where I'd be driving and be almost like talking to Brian in my head. And in the book, he is actually a real character in the book. And so probably about halfway through the trip, I started thinking, this is more about me, because the in the book, her name's Elizabeth, but her real name, I won't say her real name.
I know her, by
yeah,
the
you
way.
Know, Harry knows her. So
we're
I
both
met
together.
On the plane ride back from my brother's funeral in Philly, I met a girl. I was not trying to meet a girl. It just happened where I was sort of crying on the plane. And she felt sorry for me. So we met. We ended up together. So that's that thing I was talking about earlier when I said that I'd finished the book and the relationship ended. That was with her. And so, you know, out there dealing with all these issues, I didn't realize it, that I hadn't really processed what happened to Brian, because I had Elizabeth the whole time. It's so weird. I had Elizabeth pretty much from the beginning of that grieving process, and 3.5 years into it. So it wasn't until I was out on the road that I started to really delve into my feelings about what happened to my brother and guilt that I felt about. He was at my house, you know, the night it happened, and you know, all those things. And Harry lost his brother the same year. Similar circumstances. And let's talk about that, because everybody seems really...
Well, I mean, it's...
Want to get some more wine, anybody? Can I have some wine, please? Jesus. Oh, it is there?
Yeah, it's on your right side, as it should always be.
Really, if you want to get some wine, this is the part where we're all going to cry. Go ahead.
Right, no. Right, yeah. Well, we're going to switch it up a little bit, my friend, and get off of the sad thing. We'll get into that. But I was in Wyoming. I took a similar trip, actually, in 2007, where I drove much of the United States. I did about 25 states or so. Was in Wyoming, got pulled over by the police. That's not unusual if you're a brother and driving alone in the United States.
You have California plates too.
California plates.
Oh,
and a BMW a year ahead of the game.
Oh,
so I was just asking for trouble. But in any event, we talked about the sort of natural high that is the beauty of this land of ours. What did you learn about America through its wine? What's your big takeaway after this year of self-discovery, so to speak?
Well, you know, the thing that really, and I had this idea in my head that after I got out of California, Oregon and Washington, it was gonna be like shacks, you know, and people just a guy named Cletus making wine, and there is that.
There are some.
But really, the there were beautiful moments on it. So, for instance, when that was in Bayard, Nebraska. Right after that, I went to a place called St. Paul, Nebraska. Do you know where that is, James? James is from Nebraska. Do you know where it is? It's between What the Hell Am I Doing Here and How the Hell Do I Get Out? Yeah, so that's where St. Paul, Nebraska is. And I met, it's called Meleta Vista Winery. Mick and Loretta. Get it? Mick and Loretta, Meleta Vista. And I had heard about this wine because a friend of mine, a sommelier in Sonoma, said they placed like first in this competition in Sonoma for this white wine they have called Brianna, which is a hybrid grape, because they can't grow vinifera in the middle of the country. You know, can't do it. But so I'm all right, I'm going to go visit these people. So I went out and I visit them. And I get to Mick and Loretta's place, and they were super sweet, but... you hear a lot of the same things along the way about the winemaking process. You know, there's nuances, but for the most part, it's the same. But when I got there, this was the first time I heard this. I said, well, how do you do it? You know, it's really inhospitable place to grow grapes, and there's not a big built-in clientele of wine drinkers out here, and how do you survive? And he said... well, you know, we do this all our work, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is always with us. I said, yeah, all right, great, got it. So then we had dinner, and we said grace and everything, and I was staying at their house, and then their winery had had a fire like a year and a half before, and they rebuilt it really quickly, and it looked great. And I said, Mick, how, you know, man, what a great job. Like, how'd you get this thing back up? And he said, a lot of sweat and hard work and dedication. And as I said before, Jesus is always watching over us. And I said, well, not always. Fire.
I got it.
And Mick laughed wife not so much. And then I went in, and the best was I let me look around the crowd, can I say this? No, so I went in the bedroom, and it was doilies, and it was like wood paneling, and and there was a giant crucifix, like, I mean, as big as you, in front of me, hanging on the wall. And then there was a picture of Jesus, and I was looking around, and I go, there's got to be a camera in here. There's a camera in this room somewhere. Like, this is too religious. But stuff like that, like going out and just meeting people that have no business making wine, but they're making wine. And to me, it's Bush, Louisiana. I was in, so you all know New Orleans, right? So if you go across Lake Pontchartrain, and then you go 30 miles past that, and there's no reason to ever do this, but I've done it for you. You can read about it. There's a winery out there called Pontchartrain Vineyards, and beautiful place, but I go out, and you pull in, it's Saturday afternoon, and there's a bunch of pickup trucks. I mean, not a bunch, it's all pickup trucks. And I walked in, and it's a bunch of, like, you know, people from Bush, Louisiana, hunkered down drinking wine. And I'm thinking, this is amazing. Like, Louisiana, you can't, you know. And now they were importing some grape, some juice from California, but they were also making Blanc du Bois, which is a grape that they can grow down there in the South. So I start talking to this guy, and he tells me the story about when, what was the hurricane? Katrina. And wiped the whole thing out, you know? Like, I mean, trees and this. They couldn't even get down the road to get to the winery. They had to, you know, but then they rebuilt it, and they did it. And you don't hear that in Napa. Well, I mean, they had the earthquake in Napa, but, I mean, to see how hard these people are working against the odds in places where, who's ever had a wine from Louisiana? Who's ever thought about having that guy? you're a hillbilly. I know this. Yeah, Curtis. The fact that they're doing this, and they're doing it, there's 125 wineries in Michigan. There's 80 wineries in Arizona. That's crazy. 270 in Virginia. And I don't think people know about it, you know, that it's there, and it's...
Unless you're, I mean, if you are into wine. Now, the question, I guess, the question that is begged is, in spite of your reverse, whatever this syndrome you feel or the fear that you have, are you now the leading expert on American wine? Let's say that we're going to go a mile wide and an inch deep. Do you know more about the various regions and the wines and the states than any other person?
Picking up hints of plastic. I can tell you this is from the Central Coast, just because I'm the one that got it here. But no. Am I the leading? I would say this. I've been to more American wineries probably than anybody else that's doing this for a living. Would I throw down with the Ray Isles and Robert Parkers and about, you know, no. But I would about, I could say, hey man, have you ever been to Plains, Texas? Have you been out there and met the guys growing the grapes? No. Screw you, Robert Parker.
I just, and I need to throw this in here because, as I say, I'm a former seminary. Jesus' first miracle was turning water into wine.
It was.
I think you give a short.
Nobody's topped that. No, I think I brought that up to Mick and Loretta. I was like, yeah, you know.
You should.
Nobody is that wedding. Was it wedding at Cana?
It was a wedding at Cana.
Yeah, Cana.
And they couldn't afford any more wine and so forth. And then later in some of the Gospels, and I'm not trying to proselytize, believe it. Later in the Gospel, he says, you know, a lot of the people who come around saying that they're special, don't eat and drink. You kill John the Baptist once this person. He said, I come and I eat and I drink and you call me a lush. So I think you would have been well companioned with Jesus Christ on your tour.
Trust me, there's been many a night when I've been going, where the hell is Jesus when you need him? Like, you know, make me some wine. Yeah.
You know, you and I have a lot in common just on away from the wine thing. We're kind of We come from sort of high-strung moms. We grew up in sort of hard-knock neighborhoods and so forth.
Who do you think would win in a fight? Northeast Philly or South Central or South,
South
Chicago?
South Chicago. Yeah. Did you see the Donald Trump rally when they shut it down in Chicago?
All right, you win. You win. By the way, I do have a little Trump thing teed up in here, by the way, if we want to.
Oh, do you?
Oh, yeah, I went to Trump's winery.
Really?
So.
Oh, we got to hear that.
Oh, yeah. So in the. All right. Let me. That's hold on. No, no. He has a winery. And not. It gets even weirder. No, but it's the best. It's the best wine ever. Ask him.
Right.
Yeah. There's a. So
he's going to make American grapes again.
He's going to make America's grapes again. Yeah. All right. So can we. Do you want to hear a little bit more? This is Virginia. So I'm in Virginia. Virginia. Oh, I like Virginia. I had a good time. You're from Virginia? All right. I'll read a little bit of this, and then we'll jump to Trump. So, you know, wine kind of started in Virginia, really. Congratulations. In 1760, a 17-year-old Thomas Jefferson matriculated at William & Mary in Williamsburg. College kids back then liked to drink just as much as they do today, and over the next few years, TJ fell in love with two of the most notable vinophiles in the colonies. Francis Fauquier. That's how it is, Fauquier. 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 The royal governor of Virginia, and George Wythe, Jefferson's law tutor. Both men had expansive cellars and introduced young Thomas to the pleasures of the finest old world wines. I like to imagine Jefferson's aha moment. We all had that aha moment when you have wine. You go, yeah, I think this, right? His aha moment with wine was similar to my experience drinking those incredible Bordeaux vintages with Charles Smith and Walla Walla. The parallels are eerie. For instance, after his wine awakening, Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence and helped found America. After my wine awakening, I wrote a bunch of dick jokes and binge-watched Veep. It's like we're the same person, except that I have never had sex with a slave. I think we know who has the moral high ground here. So bad. Over the next decade, Jefferson's interest in wine intensified, and he built an impressive collection of his own. Then on a fateful day in 1773, one of his wine brokers swung by Monticello with an Italian winemaker named Philip Mazzai. Mazzai had spent 18 years selling wine in London and had come to the New World with the intention of cultivating Old World grapes. Indeed, he was on his way to a parcel of land in Augusta, Georgia, that had been promised to him by the Brits. When he saw the land at Monticello, however, he immediately recognized it as primo grape-growing location with a hearty, how do you say this, footer, Georgia? See you later, Georgia. He and Jefferson struck up a partnership. Mazzai got some land and the assistance of Jefferson's uncompensated workforce in exchange for planning and maintaining vineyards at Monticello. He was also very taken with the American cause, which was cooking along underground at the time, and endeared himself to many of the founding fathers. A year later, in 1774, when the Virginia Wine Company was born, Jefferson, George Washington, and several other prominent colonists were among its financial backers. But while their ideals may have been unassailable, their timing was for shit. 2 years after the Virginia Wine Company was founded, Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence, forcing George Washington to spend an inordinate amount of time on the road and making life more than a little dicey for area winemakers. By 1778, the plucky landstealer colonists found themselves in dire financial straits. Eventually, it got so bad they sent Mazzai, their bestest paisano, who had become quite the American patriot, back to Italy to rustle up some more money for the war effort from his rich Italian friends. Rather than let his estate lie fallow during this time, Mazzai rented his place out to Heinrich Riedisel, a Hessian general captured by the Americans and being held as a prisoner of war. The fact that a POW was allowed to rent out a plush Virginia plantation is just another example of how civilized war was back then. Wait, that's wrong. Sorry, I got confused. War is never civilized. This is an example of the fact that when you're rich, you get to do whatever the fuck you want. In a development only everyone could have seen coming, it turns out Mazai Airbnb-ing his place to an opposition general was not the best idea. Radisel, in a truly impressive dick move, pastured his horses in the baby vineyards Mazai had so lovingly cared for over the previous 4 years, utterly destroying them. Jefferson later wrote that the, quote, the horses in 1 week destroyed the whole labor of 3 or 4 years, and thus ended an experiment which from every appearance would in a year or two more have established the practicability of that branch of culture in America, which imparts an important lesson. Always check the no pets box. All right, so we'll jump forward a little quickly. Thank you very much. So, there's two wineries down the street from each other, and the one was founded by a socialite named Patricia Clugy on the site of Mazai's old residence, where they had the horses. So, she bought this place, and then it didn't work out. She doubled down in 2008, put everything she had into the place, and obviously we know what happened to the economy in 2008, so the place went out of business. The ill-timed investment ended up costing her the vineyard. With her hand forced, Clugy put the house and land on the market for $100 million, but got no offers. The bank foreclosed. It was a miserable situation. And as we all know, where there is misery, there is Trump. The land was auctioned off in parcels, much of it at fire sale rates. However, the bank held out for big bucks for the plantation house itself. So Trump bought the relatively cheap parcel of land that included the house's front lawn. At that sale, Trump's general counsel commented on the house's $16 million asking price, asking, who's going to pay for a house with no front yard? They ended up picking up the house for $6.5 million after the bank apparently realized they'd been trumped. Great job ruining everything, Bank of America. Oh, and great job letting Donald Trump into the wine game. This is why we can't have nice things. So then Donald gets in and he changes all of his, changes everything to Trump now. It's no longer Clugy and he does this. So in a wonderfully jarring juxtaposition, we have more on, directly across from the road from Trump and up the street from Jefferson's old home is Blenheim Vineyards, owned by David John Dave Matthews. Maybe you've heard of him. He's a musician. Matthews built Blenheim, which opened in 2000 on a site listed in the National Historic Register of Places, or whatever that's called. So we're going to jump forward to, I did both wineries the same day. Now, I know what you're asking yourself. Did I prefer the wine of the guy? And by the way, Donald Trump was not running for president when I wrote this. So now it seems kind of prescient. But did I prefer the wine of the guy who played campaign fundraisers for Obama? Or the juice made by the guy who raised questions about his birth certificate? Honestly, it's a toss-up. Each has a high-quality Bordeaux blend in its portfolio, some lively rosé, and the crisp floral Viognier that's a staple at virtually every Virginia winery. When you factor in the socially conscious rock star and all-around good guy factor versus the raging narcissistic megalomaniac nutjob factor, it's tempting to give Blenheim the nod. Then again, if I learned anything on this trip, it's that the only common ground required between winemaker and wine lover is the stuff in the glass. Then again, one of these two vintners is on the record as saying, I have a great relationship with the blacks, and defended his decision not to share his, quote, surefire secret plan for defeating Islamic terrorists by telling the interviewer, because I don't want to. Sorry, Dave. I got to give it to Trump here. He's just that gifted of an entertainer. Yeah.
Dan, I have to bring this up because I'm from, you know, as we've established very abundantly here, I'm from Chicago. And when I was growing up, a wino was somebody who drank chemically fermented bullshit wine like, so I can't even remember.
Mogan David
and certain other things that were quite nasty. Boone's Farm.
Mogan David's made in the Finger Lakes, by the way, New York.
See? Yeah. Now, did you in your, and I, this is a two-part question, and then shortly hereafter, we should open it up to the public.
To the peeps.
Yeah. But did you enjoy any of the sort of traditional, nasty, chemically fermented varieties of wine?
No.
Okay.
No. I mean, look, there's, you know, there's some great wine around the country that I've had from Virginia and Arizona. Good wine in Arizona, good wine in Michigan. I'm not going to be, if somebody said, hey, do you want to have this, you know, Cardinal from Napa, or do you want the thing from Montana? I'm going to go with the Cardinal from Napa. Again, it was more about enjoying that they're doing it.
Mm.
And I'll drink anything.
The sort of American.
Yeah. And the other thing about this that I learned, too, is the experiential nature of wine, and I think everybody gets this. Wine isn't just about, like, sitting down with a glass of wine and saying, oh, compare this to this. It's who you're with. Where you are, like who you're drinking it with, where you are, the mood you're in, the music you're listening to, all of that has an effect on how you're going to experience the wine. And so I've gone back.
The food you're eating.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I've gone back and tasted wines that I had on the trip. And I'm like, oh, they weren't as great as I remembered them. But when I was there, they were great. You know, when I was in Louisiana, it was great. When I was in Arizona, it was great. In New Mexico, you know. They tasted good to me because I was with the people, I was with the winemakers, I was in the environment, and loved it.
To some extent,
I'm not drinking that shit anymore, though. Yeah, no.
I know you to be a tremendously versatile drinker.
Yes.
And I think we've discussed some of that, at least in.
I know you to be this, too, from our bowling nights. We've had
our bowling nights.
Many a night.
One of your blogs, I think we did a podcast. Remember we went
did.
To a
No, we did my SiriusXM show.
Yeah.
Don't podcast me.
Oh,
SiriusXM. Radio. I did have a podcast, though, too.
So, since we're speaking about the greatness of America, and now, you know, there's always the thing, you go into a store, it says wines and spirits. Wines are distinguished from spirits, I'm assuming, because of some... What? Some process of fermentation?
Why are wines different than spirits?
Why are...
That's
why,
my next... We'll do another one of these later and I'll fill you in.
You'll tell me all about it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But as an American, as a Philadelphian, the birthplace of our great democracy...
Yes.
What do you consider more American, wines or spirits? And if there is, and if the answer is the latter, what spirit is the most iconically American?
Well, there's only one that actually is the native American spirit, which is bourbon. Yeah, I'd probably say spirits. You know, we, the Europeans, the old world, they invented wine. You know, give them that.
Okay.
I'll give that to Italy. I'll give that to France. So, you know, but whiskey, bourbon, that's us, man.
Okay. And which would you prefer on any given day? Would you go toward the wine now that you're an expert or a leading?
I'm drinking
expert?
More wine these days.
Okay.
But that said, if you've got some good bourbon right now, we'll do that. Yeah. Anybody? Anybody have it? So, yeah.
Very cool.
That's the next one.
That's right. So, should we go to the and see if they have some pointed questions for you?
Sure.
For your experiences?
Oh, man.
Scott. A man
love
of great
movie.
Taste right here.
Five Heartbeats was a great movie. Harry's in that. Yes. Give it up.
Man of great taste. If you haven't seen it, we're celebrating our 25th anniversary this year. We had just 25 years ago.
I did love that movie. Colorado had some good wines in Paonia. Paonia was where the weed came from in Colorado before it was legalized, so that's where everybody got it. And so then all those guys said, well, now what are we going to grow? We'll start growing grapes.
How did they know what they were drinking?
That's true, yeah. And maybe, by the way, I was completely high when I was in Colorado, so maybe it wasn't as good. So high, yeah, high the whole time. Colorado was, I mean, Virginia I loved. Michigan, Paw, Michigan, anybody know where that is? It's like southwestern Michigan. You wouldn't go there for any other reason than to drink the wine, I guess, but yeah. Better than Detroit. Yes.
Oh.
Well, they have a grape there called Frontenac that they grow, so it's a hybrid. Frontenac is a hybrid, I think, of Syrah and something else. So when I say hybrid grapes, a lot of these grapes are created in either at Cornell or at the University of Minnesota. They do a lot of that. So they basically take vinifera, which is Cabernet Sauvignon, Merlot, so the classic noble varieties of grapes that we all know, and then they blend them with grapes that can actually survive in those environments. And that's, so front neck grape, I remember from Wyoming. And it's, it, you know, it's all sweet. Like a lot of the stuff you're going to get in the middle of the country, not all of it, but a lot of it's going to be sweet wines, you know. And same thing in the South, where they have muscadine. And we like muscadine? Yeah. Muscadine is the preferred wine of people who have homemade fur coats. Yeah. And for whom chiggers are a major hygiene concern. Yeah. People say, what do you pair with muscadine? I'm like, whatever you hit that day in the pickup truck. Yeah. That's what you do. Grill that up. Yeah. Yes.
So what is racking?
Hi. I don't know. Racking. Yeah, no. Why? Don't try to stump me right now. Next question from somebody less aggressive. Yes. I did, and I did it that year, and it was, you know, it was anticlimactic, really, in a way, because I realized at that point it wasn't about it. We had a really great seminar there last year, and I just did one this past weekend. I just came from Pebble Beach. We did American Wino 2. This time it's personal. And it was fantastic. A lot of great people there, and yeah, you know, it was fun. I don't really feel that pressure when I got out. Like, I build it up in the book like I'm feeling the pressure, but I don't think I felt it. Like, anytime I do any kind of thing like this, if I'm here, there's something, like, I almost want to, like, screw it up really badly because I think it would be funny to do it. So it's a good attitude to have, you know. I was on Conan a few years ago, and friends of mine said, oh, my God, were you nervous when you did Conan? I said, no, not at all, because I just think I would like to watch myself fucking up on Conan. You know, like have that video and be like, yes, I totally screwed up. It was such a mess. Of course, I haven't done that yet. I'm brilliant.
Right? How do you ghostwrite a book about It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
With him. Me and this guy wrote it. Scott, right there. Scott Alexander. We basically watched a ton of Sunny episode. We watched every Sunny episode, and then he and I would talk, and we'd say, what are we gonna do? Like, it was a self-help book, so it was little, you know, relationships, and what else was it? Money, fashion, some shit, yeah. And then career, then we would go, all right, well, here's an idea. Yeah. And then make it funny, yeah, yeah. So, and then he would write one, and I'd write one, and then we'd swap them and send them to Glenn and Rob, the guys from the show, and they'd say, this is great, and yeah. We banged that out. That was 2.5 months, 75,000 words, 2.5 months.
And I know you've done rather a few scripts for presentation, you know.
Oh, and as you've seen all my movies, right? Yeah. Oh, no. By the way, you could play me in American Wino.
I'm all for it. I've got
all
the.
Right, there we go.
Yeah, I've got the pedigree.
There we go. You're in. There we go. Harry Lennix, American Wino. Police. What's that?
You have to ride in the police
dock. Yes, exactly.
Right. Yeah. There you go.
I got stopped. I got pulled over in Oregon. It was. I drove from Calistoga all the way up through the redwoods and the whole thing. It was the longest day of driving that I had because there was a traffic jam, and I went through the redwood forest, and that was beautiful, and I stopped, and I got to Oregon, and I was like, oh my God, this is so beautiful, but I'm exhausted. I don't know if I'm going to do this. So I'm going, and I get to Bandon, Oregon. Does anybody know Bandon, Oregon? So I got there, and I'd been on the road for about 12 hours. I could see the hotel. See it. 100 yards ahead. Woo! God pulls me over. This is in the book. He pulls me over, and he comes up, and he just looked like he just got out of, you know, he's big guy, buzz cut. And I was, oh, what was I doing? I was speed. I was doing 46 in the 35, you know, or 54 in the 55, as Jay-Z happened. So, and he said, you from California? He's got the plates, the California plates. I said, well, yeah, I'm from Philadelphia, but, yeah, no. He said, what are you doing here? To which I wanted to say, I'm actually here for the none of your goddamn business convention. But cops hate when you say that, you know. So I was like, I'm writing a book actually about the best places to go in America, and Bandon. Here I am, Bandon. And he said, oh, you're a writer? Yeah, me too. Pat's the ticket thing goes back, comes back.
Whoa. Oh, yeah. Smart, funny guy.
There you go. Ticket. And I learned a valuable lesson then was, I was like, yeah, I guess if you have California plates, and by the way, once you get in the middle of the country, and I have a Toyota SUV, that's bad too. California plates, not non-American made car, middle of country. Yeah, you're... That, no more speeding.
That was my experience, and so I presume that you abandoned as soon as you could?
Abandoned, I got out of there as quickly as I could.
Very cool.
Now, Oregon was great. Questions? Anybody else? Yes. Hi. Good to see you, by the way.
How are these guys doing? Do they all have a future? I mean, do they sell their wine beyond, like, are they mass distributed?
I think so. I mean, you know, look, I just read a report recently. It said millennials are drinking wine more than anything else, more than beer, more than spirits, drinking wine. No, I think they do, because everywhere I went, the places were packed. Texas, Hill Country of Texas, is the third leading wine tourism place in America, behind Napa and Sonoma. You go there, Fredericksburg, Texas, there's thousands of people like go at these wineries. And yeah, I think they do have a future, because it's wine. It's great. Yeah. Yes, sir, in the back. Can somebody throw this guy out? It's clearly. I'm sorry. How much wine have you had, sir? Dennis McGlynn, will you translate for him, please? Yeah, no. Millennials, what? It could be, yeah. And I mean, look, they're, you know, beer's always going to be great. You know, whiskey and all that stuff's going to be great. But people are drinking a lot of wine because wine's great. Don't mess with him. He's from Nebraska. We don't want to make him angry. Who else has a question that makes sense? Yes.
Since you're in New York, Long Island has a lot of wineries, and
No, I didn't see that. What would I pair Long Island wines with? I'd pair them with wines from Pennsylvania. You know why? Because we would win. Yeah, Philly. There's a lot of New York Philly animus in the book as well. There's a part in there when I'm on the New Jersey Turnpike heading down to Philly, and I talk about our relationship between our two cities. I didn't go to Long Island. I went to the Finger Lakes, and I like the wines there. You know, and it's a great, again, another great place to go. You know, if I lived here, I'd be taking trips up there all the time. Orly, question? Oh, I thought you looked inquisitive. No, nothing?
I believe we're getting a high sign from Caitlin. And then
we're done? Oh, now I got to sign these things? Oh, my God. Jesus. One more question. Yes. James's question, actually, yeah.
Something you read about and you're like, oh wow, I'm really excited, and then, oh my God, why did I bother? Or something that you read, why am I even going there, and then got there and said, wow.
I really wasn't disappointed. I mean, obviously in the West Coast, everything was great. The wines were amazing. The places were awesome. I didn't expect much when I went to Wyoming or Colorado or Iowa. I was in Des Moines, Iowa. I mean, those wines are not great in Des Moines, Iowa, but the people were great. So I really enjoyed being there, and I loved sitting down with them and drinking their wine. And when I was there, it tasted good to me because, you know, you're in that environment. And you're like, yeah, man, you guys are doing it. You're like, you're making wine. It's like corn out here. It's like corn, but no, they're making wine. So I wasn't ever disappointed. And as far as surprising me, again, Virginia, I'd probably say, would be the place that I was really kind of fell in love with the wines there. So, all right, now we got to sign books. But thank you for coming. And wait, thank you, Harry Lennix, man.
Great to be with you. Great to be with you.